everybody, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed, the television edition here on August 30th, 2016. And it is, of course, 7 p.m. here in the Eastern Time Zone if you're watching live. I know a lot of you watch later on YouTube. But I'm all alone tonight. Well, I'm not alone. P-Dub is, as Mr. Hopwood calls him, is in the other room. Our good friend Pete from the morning show with Peter White and the Moose running the, well, there's really nothing for him to do, actually, because I'm the only one here. Oh, boy, what am I going to do for the next hour? I don't even know. I'm kidding, of course. We'll discuss Trump and all kinds of other various sundries, whatever that means. I don't even really know what that means. What are sundries? And why is it always plural? Why can't you have one sundry? Pete, do you know what a sundry is? I don't even know what a sundry is.
No.
Pete doesn't know either. It does. It sounds like a Hostess snack cake. I don't think that's what it is. Maybe it's something that's sun-dried, but you don't say sun-dry, you say sundry. Like maybe it's like raisins. I don't know. Anyway, so I haven't done a show by myself for a while, actually. Well, the radio show I'm usually alone, of course, which you can hear five nights a week at 11 p.m. Eastern on IPM Nation 2. I am live most nights, although last night we did cheat and run a repeat because we just repeated Friday's show. So there was really nothing too exciting that happened over the weekend in terms of politics. But if you didn't hear it, it is up and available on demand, of course, on IPM Nation. One of the interesting things we did on the show Friday / last night was broke down the video from Hannity of Trump and his 180 on immigration, where he seemed to embrace a form of immigration reform that would allow undocumented immigrants who've been in the country for a long time to stay here. And the interesting thing about that video, and we're not going to replay it now, I already covered it on the other show, but the thing that I kind of noticed about that, and I know many of you have probably seen it, and it's on YouTube, it's easy to find if you haven't seen it, but Trump takes a poll of the crowd. It's almost like a game show. Like he asks the crowd, you know, how many people think that we should just deport everybody? And how many people think that we should at least find a way to work with people, as he put it? People who've been here for a long time, who are law abiding, who, you know, aside from breaking the law when they entered the country, haven't gotten in any trouble and whatnot, you know, and we don't want to break up their families, you know. And he kind of takes a live poll. But he does it, I think, a total of about five times. He keeps going back to it. And Trump, as much as I've been critical of him, you know, and he's not going to be president, but I'll tell you this, he is a master at manipulating a crowd. Because if you watch the video, or even if you just listen to the audio, the way he manipulates the crowd into eventually embracing his new position, or what seemed at the time in that moment to be his new position, that we're not going to round all 11 million up and deport them, but we're actually going to work with people, as he said, people who've been here a long time and generations and haven't caused any trouble. He gets the crowd on his side eventually, and he does it in a very masterful way. Now, of course, by the next day, it sounded like he had gone back to his old position, which is we're going to send everybody home, which I think is insane. For a variety of reasons. We don't need to rehash all that, but if I did get into it in detail last night on the radio show. So again, it's up, or actually it was Friday's show, if you want to take a listen. But I mean, he truly is a great showman. You know, I don't think he'd be a great president. I have a lot of questions about whether he really is the great businessman that he presents himself to be. You know, the Wall Street Journal did an analysis that said he'd have actually considerably more money right now if he had passively invested his inheritance from his dad instead of taking all the risks that he has and whatnot. But so he's had a lot of failures, but he is a master showman, and he understands how to manipulate a crowd. To watch him work that crowd when he did that interview with Hannity is a thing of, I mean, I have to admire and respect him for that much. He knows how to work a crowd. I want to open with something really positive that Obama has done, and you know, of course, I have plenty of criticisms of Obama, but when he does something good, I like to point it out. And this has been kind of a continuing story that most people don't pay much attention to be honest with you. But I think it's very positive, although I'd like to see more of this. But this just broke today. This is from Politico. Sarah Wheaton and Josh Gernstein report this this afternoon. Obama has commuted the sentences of 111 federal prisoners today, bringing his total to 673 as the administration tries to ramp up relief for nonviolent felons of decades-old sentencing requirements. Obama has granted 235 commutations in August alone, more than any other president in a single month, and has granted more clemencies than the previous 10 presidents combined. That I didn't realize. The Justice Department announced a sweeping effort in 2014 to adjust the sentences for people swept up by mandatory minimums that are now widely viewed as draconian and unjust, especially for nonviolent crimes. But while it is initially intended to grant relief to low-level drug offenders, people convicted of deeper roles in the drug dealing operations are also starting to benefit. That means that while Obama is shortening their sentences, their new terms still stretch, in some cases, into the next decade or two, long after Obama leaves office. Take Alfonso Allen as an example. He was convicted in 2009 of conspiracy to distribute more than 50 grams of cocaine base. That's how it's referred to in the text of the conviction, which is likely referring to crack is what it really is, as well as other drug offenses and drug possession charges. According to a 2011 appeal, Allen was a lieutenant in the Miami drug operation who managed several cellars. His original sentence, life in prison, plus 10 years of supervised release. And I don't know how the 10 years of supervised release figures into that when it's life in prison, but I guess in theory, I'm no expert on this, I guess if he were to be paroled, he would still have the 10 years of supervised release. But anyway, life in prison, essentially for being a drug dealer. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not trying to defend drug dealers, but I think that, you know, if you go back to the, what was it, 96, the crime bill, that the Clintons and everybody, you know, the Democrats with the Republicans, they were all excited about it. Democrats really into that at the time because they wanted to prove they were tough on crime. For example, that's why Bill Clinton presided over, I think, three times during his 1992 campaign. He flew home to Arkansas while he was governor to preside over the executions of a few high-profile people who had been convicted of murder. One of them, mentally challenged individual who there was a lot of controversy over his execution, but Bill Clinton wanted to prove he was tough on crime, so he did things like that, flew home to preside over those executions, which he was not obligated to do. They could have executed those people without him even being there. But you know, and of course the crime bill, with all its mandatory minimums, and mandatory minimums are a terrible thing. That's why sometimes people, low-level drug offenders, are sentenced to incredibly harsh 10 years in prison. And a great example of these terrible mandatory minimums is what they started doing in California, which I guess is still there. I don't mean I guess California is still there. I mean, I guess this is still in place. The three strikes law, where if you get pinched three times, you go to prison for life. And, you know, of course, people who like that kind of thing will say, well, if someone commits three crimes, obviously they're never going to be rehabilitated and we can't have them out and about and whatnot, and we need to lock them up forever. So that creates situations where maybe somebody gets pinched a couple times for something really bad, like, I don't know, armed robbery or something. And then the third time, maybe they get caught with more cannabis than is legally allowed. And that's a felony. And then they end up spending life in prison. This kind of thing happens. Mandatory minimums are terrible. And these draconian sentences for these low-level drug crimes, which are not real crimes, is terrible. What I would love to see Obama do. Now, again, this is something positive, but should have been done a lot sooner. And what I would love to see Obama do is to really, you know, this is not likely to happen. But on his way out the door, I would love to see an executive order from Obama, literally his last day in office, if he wants to wait until then, on his way out, an executive order granting clemency to everybody who is in prison for a low-level drug offense. Everybody who got caught up in the system because they possessed, you know, a plant that grows in nature that the federal government decided we need to put people in prison for. Let all of them out. Now, I don't know if that would even fly. Obviously, it would be challenged, and the Supreme Court would ultimately have to rule on it whether or not that was a constitutional executive order. And of course, you know, conservatives would be going crazy and saying, look, we told you all along, that President Obama, they would say that president, not this president, because it would be, like I said, if he waited until the last minute to do this, they'd be saying, that President Obama, he was lawless. He didn't care about the law at all. Look what he did. You know, personally, I think it would be great because I don't think we should be putting people in prison for cannabis. Or actually, I don't think we should be putting people in prison at all for drug offenses. I think it always amazes me. You know, we live in a country where it is generally accepted, even the most conservative people generally accept the premise that the prohibition of alcohol was a terrible idea, a failed experiment that created much larger problems than it could ever solve. And yet, so many of these same people can't comprehend why the prohibition of marijuana and even hard drugs, they can't seem to grasp why that's the same thing. And why that also has created much larger problems. I don't hear anybody ever arguing that prohibition of alcohol was a good idea. When I was a kid, in history class, when we discussed prohibition, it was just generally accepted that this was something really foolhardy that our country once did, prohibition of alcohol. It wasn't that silly. And look at all these problems it created. And it created far more problems than it could ever solve. Nobody argues that prohibition of alcohol was a good idea. And yet so many people cling to this idea that the war on drugs is a great thing. And of course, they're oblivious to the real reasons and motivation for the war on drugs. You know, anywhere where they're talking about legalizing or decriminalizing anything, you've got, for example, the prison lobby, because we have a private prison industry in this country. They're in there lobbying against decriminalizing or legalizing things because, of course, they want to, you know, you stop locking people up for drugs. Next thing you know, these private prisons don't have as many customers anymore, do they? And that's just one example. The pharmaceutical industry, of course, they lobby to keep all this stuff illegal because they want to keep you hooked on opiates. You know, a great way to not be hooked on opiates, use cannabis instead. So they lobby, the pharmaceutical lobby, which is very, very powerful in Washington, D.C., I'm sure they're more powerful even than the private prison lobby, which is very powerful. But they also lobby to keep all of this illegal. And that's what drug prohibition is really all about. So all of you who don't quite get it, I just explained it to you. Drug prohibition will never solve anything, just like alcohol prohibition didn't solve anything. But people continue to be so easily manipulated by these strange ideas that somehow, if we just keep fighting and keep fighting and keep fighting this war on drugs, somehow, eventually, we're going to win and there just won't be any more drug use. As somehow, if we keep that plant illegal, eventually there won't be any drug use at all. And then, of course, you've got the really old people who are so out of touch. They watched Reefer Madness once, and they don't understand why so many people think Reefer Madness is unintentionally hilarious, because they think that really happens. People smoke something, and then they act like they just dropped acid, when in reality, what happens is when someone smokes something is they act like they just smoked something. So anyway, baby steps. We're making progress little by little. More states are decrimming or legalizing, and Obama is letting some of these people out. But again, these are the frustration I have with this, even though it's a positive story on balance, the frustration that I have with this is these are infinitesimally small numbers when you consider how many people are in prison for possession of cannabis and other drugs, of course, harder drugs too. But and I know some people like to think that, you know, and actually I've heard Gary say it on Rock, Paper, Hand Grenades. Some people like to think that, well, if we've locked someone up who possessed or used cannabis, that's not why they're locked up, because we don't really lock anyone up just for that. There's usually some other offense attached to it. And some people like to think that. The problem is that's flat wrong. We do absolutely put people in prison for possession and use of cannabis. One of the ways, by the way, that people are put in prison is they're overcharged because we have a criminal justice. Again, we have a for-profit criminal justice system in this country. No mistake about it. So one of the reasons that people are charged and put in prison for this is if they have too much of it, quote unquote, too much of it, they're charged with intent to distribute. So in other words, the criminal justice system will tag that person as a drug dealer, even if they're just growing plants on their own property. Oh, you have too many plants. You obviously plan to sell these. You obviously are a drug dealer. And they may have never sold anything to anyone in their lives, but they're tagged with being a drug dealer. And then guess what? Well, we put drug dealers in prison, don't we? Whether they actually dealt anything or not. And of course, there's the civil asset forfeiture, which is where the government gets to criminally steal your stuff. You know, and there's all kinds of crazy stories about that. Somebody in law enforcement spots a plant on your property. Next thing you know, the government, with zero due process, seizes your home and all your other assets too. And good luck getting them back. I don't know how you're going to afford a lawyer when all your assets have been seized by the government. It's all rigged. It's all rigged against you. That's what the drug war is really all about. It's about government control. It's about our for-profit criminal justice system. It's about keeping the pharmaceutical lobby happy, who pay our politicians a lot of money to make sure that they're kept happy. Same thing with the private prisons. That is your drug war that so many of you love and think is such a great thing. Gotta keep fighting that drug war. And it's all a giant scam. And again, there's progress. People are starting to get it, but not nearly enough, man. A lot of you need to snap out of it here. Look, I mean, I've got this figured out, and I'm a reasonably smart guy. I'm no genius, but to me, this all kind of seems like common sense. You know, connect the dots, follow the money. None of this is complicated stuff to figure out, and what the real motivations and reasons are for this. And yet so many of y'all just don't get it. And every time, by the way, and I've heard Mark Edge says this on Free Talk Live, and I've been repeating it because I like this, because it's 100% true. Every time the police go out and arrest a local drug dealer, there tends to be an escalation in violence on the streets of that city, whatever city it is. And I'm not just here, but anywhere. And the reason for that is every time you take a drug dealer off the streets and put them in prison, and again, I'm not trying to defend drug dealers. I mean, you know, I think drug dealers generally are scumbags, but I'm just saying, practically speaking, when you take a drug dealer off the street, all you're doing is you're opening up a job opportunity for somebody else who wants that job. And there tends to be competition for those jobs because those are lucrative jobs. And in the drug trade, what happens when there's competition? You have prospective drug dealers shooting each other in the streets because they all want that job. That's how they compete for that job. Whoever survives. So then you have an escalation in violence. You end the drug war, you don't have drug dealers shooting each other in the streets. Again, none of this is complicated, yet frustratingly few people get it. I don't know how to make it any simpler. But that's how it works. And you know, it's not just, it, it's there's also too the basic principles of, you know, the libertarian idea that if it's a, unless it's directly harming somebody else, you have a right to do what you want, ingest whatever substance you want, you know, and that's your right, which I fundamentally agree with as well. We're all responsible for our own decisions. That's another thing too. It's funny. The government knows best in terms of what drugs you can or can't use. But if you want to drink yourself into a coma with alcohol, go right ahead. As long as you're not operating heavy machinery, the government doesn't mind a bit. And of course, if you want to kill yourself with cigarettes, feel free by all means. I mean, cigarettes are far more harmful than cannabis could ever be. But that's okay. After all, the government is, they really want you smoking. You know, because why do you think we have those big tobacco subsidies? Right, the government's in the cigarette business. They want you to smoke. They want you to kill yourself with cigarettes. That's great. That's profit. The tobacco lobby, also very powerful in Washington. So, the government will gladly help you to harm yourself if it's something that they profit from. But otherwise, forget it. They know what's best. I mean, if it were really about, you know, looking out for people's health and well-being, I mean, what's the number one killer of people in this country, right? Heart disease, last I knew. So should the government, because the government apparently knows best, they know what's best for us, should the government outlaw any kind of junk food? Should the government outlaw fast food? Maybe outlaw anything that's high in cholesterol? I mean, it's the government's job to look out for us, right? That's why all these terrible drugs are illegal, because the government knows best. Well, if heart disease kills more people, I mean, for example, I know for a fact, without even looking at any statistics, heart disease kills more people than cannabis does. You know how I know? Because heart disease, like I said, last I looked, was the number one cause of death in this country. And how many people have died from cannabis over the course of human history? Zero. So I think it's time. I think we're going to have to do it, guys. If we're going to be consistent, we're going to have to outlaw any food that is not healthy for you. So put down those Oreos. The government's going to come and take them away from you. They have to. They're looking out for you. They know what's best. All right. I did not intend to take up half the show with that. But moving along. Some more breaking news. Don't worry. We'll get to Trump. I know everyone loves hearing me ramble about Trump. But this was just updated on CNN.com a couple hours ago regarding Hillary. FBI set to release report on Hillary Clinton email investigation as soon as Wednesday. It says here the FBI plans to make public agent notes from Clinton's voluntary interview at FBI headquarters, not being released interviews of Clinton aides or other investigative materials. And then there's a couple paragraphs here. It goes into a little bit more detail. The FBI expects to publicly release as soon as Wednesday the report the Bureau sent to the Justice Department in July recommending no charges in the Hillary Clinton email server investigation, according to multiple law enforcement officials. The release is in response to numerous FOIA requests, including from CNN. FOIA, for if you don't know, it's Freedom of Information Act. Also to be released is Hillary Clinton's 302. The FBI agent notes from Clinton's voluntary interview at FBI headquarters. The report is about 30 pages, and the 302 is about a dozen pages, according to the officials. Not yet being released are additional notes from interviews of Clinton aides. Last month, FBI Director James Comey recommended against charges for Clinton, etc. So, let's see. Also, skipping down a little bit, the State Department has announced that it may have uncovered additional documents related to the 2012 attack on the U.S. consulate in Benghazi among those turned over by the FBI. So there's also that. So there's this slow drip drip. You know, the email scandal, Hillary's email scandal, continues to not go away. But it is a slow drip. And in the end, it's not going to matter. Look, I know many of you are horrified every time I say this, but it's almost September, my friends. Presidential elections are historically extremely predictable. Have there been exceptions? Of course. 2000, Bush versus Gore, that dragged on for weeks because of Florida and voting irregularities and hanging chads and all that. Okay. But generally, elections are very predictable. Presidential elections are very predictable. So there can always be exceptions. But typically, historically, we know by the middle of August who is going to win. It just is what it is. I'm sorry to the Trumpkins or Trumpeters or whatever, Trump supporters. a lot of my very good friends are Trump supporters. I take no great joy in saying this, especially because I take no great joy in the idea of a Hillary Clinton presidency. If you're a regular viewer or listener of the show, you know I don't like either of these people. I hate the two-party system. I'm voting for Libertarian candidate Gary Johnson, just as I did in 2012. So I take no joy in saying this, but it's going to be Hillary. We already know by the middle of August. Whoever is ahead in the polls in the middle of August usually wins, even if it's by a thin margin, even if it's within the margin of error. I was thinking about, and I might have mentioned it on the show the other day, 2004, Bush versus Kerry. That was a close election. That came down to Cuyahoga County in Ohio. If Cuyahoga County had gone for John Kerry, John Kerry would have been president. But even 2004, which is the next closest election that I could think of to 2000, even 2004, as razor-thin close as that was, I remember the summer of 2004. Bush and Kerry, they would be within, every poll I saw, they would be within a couple of points of each other. Just a couple of points, well within the margin of error. But what did I notice throughout the summer of 2004? As close as every poll was, if one of them were ahead, unless it was dead even, like 42-42 with, the rest undecided. Unless it was dead even, if one of them were ahead, even if it were only by 1 point, it was always Bush. As close as the polls were, Bush was always ahead. And sure enough, on election day, Bush won. Presidential elections are very predictable. Hillary Clinton, she's been in the lead for a while. Coming out of the conventions, she got a much bigger post-convention bump than Trump did. This election is already over. It's going to be Hillary. Live with it. And if Ryan Spreebus and the RNC is smart, which I question, but if they are, they will pull any future funding from the Trump campaign that the RNC contributes and focus on trying to save, because the Republicans are going to lose the whole thing. Trump is going to have, it's inevitable, and they know it. They're already preparing for it. Trump is going to have a terrible down ballot effect for the Republicans. And it's going to be a very tough year for the Republican Party. And what will they learn from it? Probably nothing. After Romney blew it in 2012, there was a lot of talk about the Republican Party needs to figure out how to reach out to Hispanics, stop alienating Hispanics, stop talking about deporting people, etc. Hispanics, the fastest growing demographic in this country. And of course, they forgot all about that within weeks. And it was right back to a lot of Republicans talking about deporting a lot of people. The Republican Party is determined to not learn from any of this. And I presume will continue to not learn from any of this. And they will not learn anything from Trump calling undocumented immigrants rapists and all that. But they are going to have to recover from it. And there is precedent for the RNC cutting off funding and, just cutting bait on the nominee. It happened in 96. So it's not like it would be that unusual. In 1996, they had to do it. It was Bob Dole challenging Bill Clinton. And I vividly, it was 20 years ago, but I vividly remember Bob Dole had no, I still can't believe Republicans nominated Bob Dole. Bob Dole had no chance at all of beating Bill Clinton for the presidency. He was a terrible choice for a nominee. And as it became obvious as the election day grew near, I think if I remember this correctly, Bob Dole, it was his idea. I think he did so voluntarily. He told, I don't know who was running the RNC at the time, but he told them, don't send me any more money for my campaign. Don't spend any more resources on my campaign. I'm going to get crushed. We all know I'm going to get crushed. And he did. I mean, Bill Clinton easily cruised to a second term. But, you know, Bob Dole said, focus these resources and this money where it should go, where it has a chance of doing some good, because it's not going to get me elected. And he was right. So let's see. There's some polling. This is from Reuters. Some polling. Now we're getting really into the Trump stuff for this week. That suggests that Republican voters wish they had picked a different nominee. They have voters' remorse. They're unhappy with Donald Trump, but can't agree on anything else. And this was updated a few hours ago. It says here, 17 candidates ran for the Republican presidential nomination this year. A majority of GOP voters now say that they wish they'd picked one of the 16 who weren't Donald Trump, according to a new HuffPost YouGov survey. The public as a whole is less than impressed with either party's nominee. Just 20% of all voters say that Trump was the Republicans' best choice, while 30% think Hillary Clinton was the Democrats' best option. So this remorse isn't just on the Republican side. Although it shouldn't surprise us. I mean, Hillary Clinton, extremely unpopular with her own constituency, and, you know, had there not been superdelegates involved controlling the process, I wonder if Bernie Sanders may have had a legitimate shot at being the nominee. And by the way, there has been quite a bit of polling data to suggest that Bernie Sanders would have a much better chance of beating Trump. I mean, Hillary's going to beat Trump, but Sanders would have been a much stronger opponent for Trump than Hillary would, which is interesting. It says here, dissatisfaction with Trump, however, extends within his own party. Republican and Republican-leaning voters say by a 19-point margin, 54 to 35, that Donald Trump wasn't the best option in this year's pool of candidates. In a June HuffPost YouGov poll, those voters were evenly split, with 44% saying Trump was the best choice and another 44% saying the party could have done better. That was in June. So that has shifted significantly in a short time. Meanwhile, a majority of Democratic and Democratic-leaning voters are still satisfied with their nominee. 53% say Clinton was their party's best option, with 37% saying she was not. In June, the split was 56 to 32, so not a ton of movement there. Despite Republicans' unhappiness, they're no closer than ever to coalescing around an alternative. Asked who they'd like to see win their primary, if they could start the process over. If I could turn back time. I apologize for that. A 29% plurality of, hey, at least I'm not wearing what Cher wore in that video. You really don't want to see that. Look it up on YouTube if you don't know what I'm talking about. A 29% plurality of Republican and Republican-leaning voters picked Trump, with his nearest rival, Senator Ted Cruz, trailing at 15%. Both numbers are identical to the results in June. 14% named Marco Rubio. The remaining candidates were selected by fewer than 10%. By the way, and I've said many times on this show, for the second time in a row, Republicans have almost virtually ignored the person in the race who would be the best general election candidate. John Kasich, who, Governor John Kasich of Ohio, did he even win in the Ohio primary? I can't remember. He must have, right? God, I hope he did. To lose his own state would be humiliating. Governor John Kasich would have been a phenomenal general election candidate and would have crushed Hillary Clinton in the general election. Would have been a phenomenal candidate. But we know how the game is played on both sides. You know, for the Republicans, you know, you have to appear as conservative as possible to win the primaries, to mobilize the conservative base, just like on the Democratic side, you try to look as liberal as possible to win the primaries and try to mobilize the base. And then you have to try to pivot to the middle, pivot, something Trump hasn't bothered to do much of, which is one of the reasons he'll lose, and he wants to lose, in my opinion. Kasich looked like too much of a liberal. He wasn't in favor of gay marriage, but he was okay with it, didn't want to continue to fight about it. He went in for the Medicaid expansion in his state. He reminded me of what George W. Bush, when George W. Bush used to refer to himself as a compassionate conservative. That's what John Kasich to me is. But, and John Kasich 20 years ago would have been considered a conservative, even 10 years ago. I used to think he was a pretty conservative guy, very anti-union. I thought he was pretty conservative. Now he gets tagged as a liberal. Jeez, I think Reagan today, if he were exactly the same as he was in 1980, I think he'd get tagged as a liberal. My God. John Kasich would have been a phenomenal general election candidate. But, of course, you guys didn't want him. Too liberal. Plus, you were all duped by Trump, believing that he actually even wants to be president, which he doesn't. I'm convinced of that. And it was the same thing in 2012. You had John Huntsman, former governor of Iowa. By far, of anybody on that debate stage during the 2012 debates, by far would have been the best general election candidate and would have crushed Obama. But no! He couldn't get any traction either. John Hopwood voted for, I'd point to him like he's sitting there, which he's not this week, but John Hopwood, we'll pretend he's there. John, you voted for Huntsman. He did. John Hopwood, and he's a Democrat, but he voted for John Huntsman. He voted in the Republican primary that year and voted for Huntsman. Phenomenal general election candidate, but couldn't get any traction in the primaries. Look at what they did in 96. I don't remember who else ran in 96 other than Bob Dole. But I'm sure there was someone who would have been a better nominee than Bob Dole. And that's not a knock on Bob Dole. I kind of like Bob Dole. Bob Dole, moderate Republican. Today, he'd probably get tagged as a liberal. But the dude was just, I mean, come on. he would have been older than Reagan. By the way, I think Trump would be older than Reagan if Trump were to be inaugurated, which he won't be. Anyway, there's some polling data that shows Republican voters have some remorse. Let's see. You know who loves Donald Trump? David Duke. He continues his bromance with Donald Trump. Now, and that's, by the way, taken from this Reuters article. Now, of course, that's not entirely fair because Trump has not shown the same deference to David Duke. But I just think it's kind of hilarious the way David Duke continues to try to hitch his wagon to Donald Trump, which does not do Trump any favors. I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm sure there's some good old boys down south with their Confederate flags on the back of their pickup trucks who just love the fact that David Duke continues to try to hitch his wagon to the Trump train. But it's not going to help him much in the general election. If anything, David Duke, I think, is a drag on the campaign. But he's out there. It says here, and by the way, looks like he's running for the, David Duke is running for Senate. Not that he's going to get very far. But it says here, white nationalist David Duke, the former KKK Grand Wizard, who is running for the Senate in Louisiana, reiterated his support for Trump as president in a robocall urging people to vote for the pair. See, he keeps trying to make it look like they're together. It's actually really kind of funny. Duke said in a robocall, quote, "It's time to stand up and vote for Donald Trump for president and vote for me, David Duke, for the U.S. Senate." Oh, my God. Can you imagine? Like, what must, you know, Kellyanne Conway, who's now running the Trump campaign, what must she think when she sees and hears this? How insane must it make her that this is out there and that David Duke continues to do this kind of thing, and there's nothing they can do to stop him? You know, David Duke has a First Amendment right to say things like vote for Donald Trump and me. It's like Duke is trolling them, except he's not really trolling them. He sincerely loves Donald Trump, I think. Duke says also in the recording, quote, "Unless massive immigration is stopped now, we'll be outnumbered and outvoted in our own nation. It's happening. We're losing our gun rights, our free speech. We're taxed to death. We're losing our jobs and businesses to unfair trade. We're losing our country. Look at the Super Bowl salute to the Black Panther cop killers," unquote. I miss that, by the way. Perhaps because I'm not into football, was this like a halftime thing during the Super Bowl? There was some sort of a salute to some Black Panthers who killed some cops. I mean, I missed it. David Duke is one of the most recognizable figures from the white supremacist far right. The Southern Poverty Law Center describes Duke as a, quote, "neo-Nazi longtime Klan leader and an international spokesman for Holocaust denial," unquote. How would that be in a robocall, by the way? "Join me and Donald Trump in our denial of the Holocaust." Can you imagine? He's also a vocal supporter of Trump for president, and this robocall is just his latest embrace of the former reality television star. Earlier this year, Duke encouraged his radio show listeners to volunteer for Trump's campaign. He also praised Trump's run for president, saying it's, quote, "very, very important that Trump wins," unquote, and expressed in his video announcement for his run for Senate how excited he was about Trump's rise to power. Duke's own website is littered with posts in support of Trump and echoes many of the themes Trump has run on, such as a distrust of immigrants and anger towards the media. Boy, with friends like those, huh, Donald? Duke's strategy to invoke Trump is shrewd. That's because the white nationalist movement, which has festered on the political margins for decades, is experiencing an alarming resurgence in mainstream culture, with its current manifestation branded as the alt-right. That's a term you may have heard recently, which of course is short for alternative right. The shift is at least in part related to the unprecedented boost that white supremacy groups have received during Trump's campaign. The relationship between Trump and Duke hasn't exactly been reciprocal. Trump eventually disavowed Duke's support and has publicly denounced white supremacy. Oh, that's bold of him. But continues to wink to its supporters. He denies he's a racist, but continues making racist remarks. His ever-changing immigration policies include the deportation of millions. He has pledged to ban Muslims, blah, blah, blah. You know all that already. Let's see. CNN's Jim Acosta tweeted a statement from the Trump campaign in reaction to the Duke robocalls. Okay, so this is on their radar. They know Duke is continuing to troll them, even though trolling isn't his intention. It's really just, I think David Duke probably has a bit of a man crush on Mr. Trump, but let's see. So they tweeted a statement from the Trump campaign saying that it had no knowledge of these calls, but nevertheless strongly condemned and disavowed them. And the statement read as this: Mr. Trump has continued to denounce David Duke and any group or individual associated with a message of hate. There is no place for this in the Republican Party or our country. We have no knowledge of these calls or any related activities, but strongly condemn and disavow them. It is having an effect, fairly or not. And it also, just a little bit more here, it says last week, Democratic nominee Hillary Clinton, linking Trump with white nationalists and the radical fringe of the alt-right, delivered a blistering attack on what she said was the fringe movement's takeover of the Republican Party. Leaders of the extremist ideology were thrilled by Clinton's strong rebuke and declared that they were no longer alternative, but in fact, the mainstream right. This is fascinating how this all kind of feeds on itself. Well, guys, we've made it, wrote Andrew Anglin, founder of neo-Nazi website The Daily Stormer. Hillary Clinton is giving a speech about us today. So they love the attention, the alt-right movement. They do. They love the attention. They feel it legitimizes them. You know the Clinton campaign loves it because right or wrong, fairly or unfairly, and I don't think it's particularly fair, to be honest with you, as much as I don't like Trump. But it gives them a weapon to use against Trump, and it's like I said, I mean, I bet if you know, David Duke continuing this stuff may be a part of what helps get Hillary elected. This whole thing, it's like, this is part of why we know this election is already over. It's the perfect storm for Hillary Clinton to be elected. And again, I know my Republican friends don't like hearing that, but it's just the reality of it, guys. And a lot of you already know this. This election is already over. And I mentioned Kellyanne Conway earlier. This is something short that popped up on Politico. Trump campaign manager says, sad that Clinton allies have turned to name-calling. Oh, that's a pot-meat-kettle moment there. Not that Kellyanne Conway has called anyone names, but Donald Trump calls people names all the time. It says here, Kellyanne Conway laced into David Plouffe on Tuesday, days after the former campaign advisor to Barack Obama called the GOP nominee a psychopath. Responding to that comment and Hillary Clinton's speech tying Trump to white supremacists and the KKK last week, Conway had three words on Fox News Radio's Kilmeade and Friends. Shame on them. She went on to say, I mean, the name calling has reached a fever pitch, and it just tells you they got nothing. They got no game, unquote. Conway told host Brian Kilmeade. Well, there's more to this, but it doesn't matter. The point is, when the campaign manager is saying, you know, shame on them for name calling, the campaign manager of Donald Trump, and Kellyanne Conway, I mean, she, you know, she does a good job for the most part. I mean, she does the best she can, right, in the position that she's in. But, you know, she's pretty smooth. You know, she's been at this a while. But there's no way to, I mean, what do you do there? You know, I think she should be more, let me put it this way. She should be more specific in her rebuke of those comments. She should say something like, well, calling Mr. Trump a psychopath or using such terminology and questioning his mental state in that way or something, I think is inappropriate. That would be a way to kind of react to that and respond to that. But to say something like, well, I don't like the name calling, well, that's a little too easy for someone like me to see and go, wait a minute, Trump does that all the time. If you don't like the name calling, you don't like what your own candidate does? Your boss, Donald Trump? I mean, what when Trump refers to Hillary as Crooked Hillary, or Marco Rubio as Little Marco, or Ted Cruz as Lion Ted, oh, but you don't like the name calling? Let's see, we're almost out of time. There's a fun article that I found, 7 Reasons Why Donald Trump Would Hate Being President, but we'll save that for the radio show tonight. A little bit about Gary Johnson. So I think Gary Johnson, unfortunately, is not going to be in the debates. I was very hopeful that he would be, but he has not reached consistently the 15% threshold nationally. He did say on Yahoo News earlier that he thinks he has a better than 50% chance. He said, quote, right now we're reaching over 30 million people on social media. Of course, at the fringes, that just means they're hearing the name for the first time. Really optimistic this is going to happen. Unfortunately, based on, you know, there was this one article I found, I think it was last week or the week before, the debate commission was having plans drawn up that included a third podium in case Gary Johnson did meet the threshold, but it doesn't sound good. There's more to that if you want. It's up on Yahoo News if you want to see the interview that they did with Gary Johnson. And then 538.com, which is Nate Silver's website, which, you know, they analyze statistics and whatnot politically. Harry Enten put this article up today. It says, Gary Johnson isn't fading or rising. It says here, Gary Johnson doesn't seem to be going anywhere. In recent elections, third-party candidates have tended to lose support as Election Day approaches. But the Libertarian Party presidential nominee and former New Mexico governor is holding steady in the polls. And we've reached a point in the race at which past third-party candidates had already started to see their support nosedive. That's the good news. You know, he's gotten to that 9%, and he hasn't fallen at all. So that's positive, but Johnson is pulling in about 9% in the national polls, according to 538 polls only average. And his share in the national elections has not fallen as we've gotten closer to the election. Indeed, Johnson's support right now is higher than many other viable third-party candidates at a similar point in campaigns since 1948, and they kind of break that down online. It's at 538.com if you want to see it. Johnson is pulling in at least twice as much of the vote as Henry Wallace or Strom Thurmond was in late August 1948, as Ralph Nader was in 2000, and certainly as Johnson himself was 4 years ago. 4 years ago, I think Johnson got 1% of the vote. Perhaps even more impressive is that Johnson is pulling right at about where Ross Perot was in 96, when Perot had a nationally known name after his strong 1992 run. That said, Johnson is nowhere near, and here's the bad news, nowhere near the success of that 1992 campaign. Perot was pulling in 20% as a hypothetical candidate after leaving the campaign in July of 92 before re-entering the race in October. And notice, most third-party candidates didn't lose that much support between late summer and Election Day. Besides John Anderson in 1980, no candidate ended up finishing more than 3 percentage points below where they were pulling in late August. The average drop-off is about 2 percentage points. So if you want to see this in detail, it's up at 538.com. But here's the upshot of this. Gary Johnson, again, doing much better than last time. In 2012, he pulled about 1%. He's at 9% right now in averaging in polls, which is great. But he's not getting to 15, which he needs for the debates. The upshot, though, is this. He's not gaining ground or losing ground. He's holding steady. That's bad news for Trump. I can tell you that much. Because he's going to pull way more votes away, I believe, from Trump than he is from Hillary. Jill Stein will pull some votes from Hillary, but nowhere near as many as Gary Johnson will pull from Trump, in my estimation. But it doesn't sound like he's going to make it onto that debate stage. But this is progress, my friends. Those of you who are independents like me, who hate the two-party system, this is progress. We're getting there. And remember this, 43% of the national electorate is independents. So we can, as independents, if you're an independent like me, we can have an effect. And anybody who tells you that you're throwing your vote away if you vote for Gary Johnson or for Jill Stein or for any other independent, if you don't vote for Hillary and you don't vote for Trump, oh, they'll tell you, you're throwing your vote away. Ross Cirio said that recently on this show. Why would you throw your vote away? No, I disagree. You're throwing your vote away if you vote for someone who you don't believe is the best person for the job. If you vote for whomever you think is the lesser of two evils and you pretend to be locked in this two-party paradigm, this left-right paradigm that is constructed by them to keep us locked into it. Vote your conscience, like Ted Cruz said. Of course, they booed him. Vote your conscience. Vote for who you think is really the best person for the job, because the only way we're going to get out of this two-party paradigm, which I think is so terrible for the country, the only way we're ever going to get out of it is if we stop buying into the lie that to vote for anyone else is throwing your vote away. If 43% of the national electorate is independents, what would happen if all 43% of those independents stopped voting for Republicans and Democrats and said, no more. This two-party system is corrupt, it's rotten, and it does not work for us. And we're going to take control, and we're going to start voting for independents, and we're going to kill off these two parties, these two political gangs, as Jesse Ventura likes to refer to them, you know, the Democrips and the Republicans. What would happen if we all just said enough and stopped falling for the lie that you're throwing your vote away if you don't vote within the two-party system? And we're getting there. Progress is being made. I think Gary Johnson is going to do very well on Election Day. Obviously, he's not going to be president. It's going to be Hillary. But Gary Johnson is definitely having an impact, much more than he did last time. And I think it's only going to get better in the future. And eventually, I don't know if it'll happen in my lifetime, but eventually we'll break the two-party system. I believe we can do it. That's it. We're out of time. Of course, join me for the radio edition of Unleashed tonight, five nights a week, Monday through Friday, 11 p.m. Eastern on IPM Nation 2. And of course, if you missed any part of tonight's live show, we'll get it up on YouTube. Usually Brendan sends it to me first thing in the morning, and then we get it up for you. And you can watch it at your leisure, if you will, and various other sundries. I figured I'd throw that word in again. All right. Thanks, everybody. I'll talk at you all later. Good night.